The Quarto Group presents The Backyard Beekeeper, written by Kim Flottum, read by Gary Tiedemann. Preface. Since the first edition of this book was published more than 15 years ago, a tsunami of change has crashed over the beekeeping world. We must look anew at what it is to be a beekeeper. But even though so much has changed, much of the fundamental information remains. Of course, much of the attention bees, beekeepers, and beekeeping have received in the past several years can be attributed to, as the scientists will tell you, the multifactorial causes that result in an unhealthy, or worse, dead colony of bees. One USDA researcher summed it up as the problems of the four Ps: parasites, predators, pesticides, and pasture. Primary among the issues causing honeybee colony problems is the varroa virus. Varroa mites are a relatively new parasite on honeybees, and the adaptation of bees to mites and mites to bees is still in its infancy. Artificial control with synthetic chemicals invites a buildup of resistance, and the chemicals fail too soon. Still, mites are kept in check with various mixes and concoctions. There are, fortunately, noble exceptions beginning to appear in small, select populations of honeybees that can deal with mites and their viruses on their own. Almost all are feral colonies living alone, isolated from contaminated colonies. And there are some managed populations headed by beekeepers intent on finding that key element that feral colonies have used. But even in managed colonies where mite populations are kept artificially low with chemicals, the number of viruses routinely transmitted continues to increase, along with their rising virulence. The list of weapons grows shorter, and we must find another means of attack. The varroa virus attacks hungry or immune system challenged bees. In some rural areas, good nutrition remains elusive because of the pressures of big ag. Sterile aisles between rows of crops unused by honeybees also lack nutritional vegetation. Crops that are attractive and offer food for bees include tiny bits of poison. Constant exposure to low levels of agricultural poisons have rendered the landscape a hostile place for bees. Poisons have an afterlife. No amount of refining removes all the poison from beeswax. The very foundation of beekeeping, those waxen sheets we use to direct construction in a beehive, are toxic. Bees are exposed to poison from day one until the day they die, too early. None of these factors on their own is the killing blow. Rather, it is the many complex combinations of factors that put constant, perpetual stress on honeybees, leaving them with challenged immune systems, inadequate diets, and damaged bodies, and making them vulnerable to viruses. Big ag has other negative effects. Ever-increasing acres of crops require honeybee pollination to produce our food. Commercial beekeepers must choose management techniques that favor healthy bees in time for seasonal crops. This removes many of the colonies formerly used to produce honey. This has reduced domestic honey production. We are now importing nearly 80% of the honey consumed in the United States each year. This double whammy, fewer bees, less honey, has an additional side effect. Rather than spend time, energy, and resources producing bees resistant or tolerant to varroa, the industry continues to produce bulk bees and queens to pollinate with, and kills mites on them with chemicals. Add the average colony losses each summer and winter from weather, other pests and diseases, and management failures, and beekeepers find it is more lucrative to produce bees for those who lose bees than it is to produce honey. This is so easy to avoid. Unlike commercial, large-scale beekeepers, the backyard beekeeper has control over the integrated pest management schemes that deal with varroa and to the amount of exposure to big ag their bees are subjected to. they have some access to bees adapted to their specific locations and continuous selection of those lines of bees that thrive where they live. This is a small, steady step in the right direction. Enough good food all the time is also being addressed. Acres of unused and marginal lands are being converted by corporations and highway, parks, and forestry departments to accommodate all pollinators. Since the last edition of this book, the whole concept of pollinator protection has reversed itself. Towns and cities are turning the corner on asphalt, lawns, and pretty but inedible flowers for pollinators. The same is happening in the big ag fields. Between crop rows in those barren aisles, forages are being planted. Herbicides are looked at with less esteem and more caution, and governments are rethinking land use policies to accommodate more pollinators, whether bees, birds, bats, or butterflies. The sun is rising just a little on these dark issues. When these issues and symptoms first evolved, they were given a name: colony collapse disorder, CCD. The world eventually agreed it was not a singular disease or disorder, but the effects of some combination of nutrition, pesticides, both beekeeper-applied and industrial agriculture, varroa, viruses, Nosema disease, stress, and other factors. We know more about the problems we face than ever before. Yet, we are little closer to solving these problems than we were decades ago. Every year, 30 to 40% more of our honeybee colonies die from virus, poor nutrition, and pesticide exposure, or some combination of these. Several countries have banned some classes of pesticides. Dietary supplements for bees have flourished. New varroa control strategies have come forth, and whole generations of beekeepers have appeared, concerned and committed to helping honeybees. But this, too, has an unpleasant side. A subset of these newest members of the club offer no interference, no assistance, and simply letting bees be bees. Termed treatment-free, or survivors, they are left to their own devices to handle mites, food, and the elements. Those that survive are the bees they want, it's reasoned, and those that don't weren't meant to reproduce. This is a good way to make queen selections and promote genetic traits that should continue, but even with this objective, the colony that doesn't thrive is taken out of the program, and its genes are abandoned, but not the bees. To sacrifice entire colonies is cruel and makes no sense. Those colonies that manage to survive in this first scenario will eventually requeen themselves, or the beekeeper will use stock from this colony to raise queens. But when that queen mates with drones from a nearby colony raised the traditional way, those positive attributes will be lost or significantly diminished. Colonies perish, and little gain has been made. You are your neighbor's beekeeper. We have learned good lessons. In killing varroa, we have sullied our hives and rendered them nearly unlivable for our bees, and in the process, dirtied every bit of the beeswax in this country. We know more about what bees need to eat and when they need it, and we know we must feed them because nature often doesn't. We know more about varroa and what it and its virus load can do to a bee, colony, or close-knit collection of colonies. We know that the world of industrial agriculture keeps getting better at killing insects and our bees. But we've learned ways to counteract these problems, to fix what went wrong, and to do things a better way, so varroa, not enough food, pesticides, and viruses don't stop us from enjoying the ways of our bees. You will begin your beekeeping adventure knowing what can go wrong, and will be well armed with new information, plus the tried and true ways of beekeeping. You will be a smarter, better beekeeper. With this book, a bit of outdoor wisdom, and a colony or two of honeybees, you will truly enjoy the art, the science, and the adventure of beekeeping. By applying what we share here, you will be able to enjoy the garden crops you harvest, the honey you and your bees produce, and the beneficial products made from the efforts of your bees and your work. What could be sweeter? Once again, we can enjoy the bees. Kim Flottum. Beekeeping is both an art and a science. Science is the knowledge, but art is the application of all of this information. Steve Rapaski, author of Swarm Essentials. Introduction. I've been around bees, beekeeping, and beekeepers for more than 40 years, and in spite of the day-to-day issues we face, there has never been a better time to have a few honeybee colonies in your backyard. They pollinate the vegetables in your garden, increase the production of your orchard trees, and make the whole neighborhood thrive. In fact, the crops that are pollinated in part or in whole by honeybees supply us with an incredible amount of our daily sustenance. Scientists and crop producers tell us that honeybee-pollinated plants may account for a third or more of our daily diet. And if you look closely, what they are mostly responsible for are the good things we eat. You would have the toast, but no jam, turkey, but no cranberries, green beans, but no almondine, and tomato sauce on our lasagna, but no herbs to flavor it. With fewer honeybees, what we could eat is diminished, and the mundane grasses, wheat, rice, corn, oats, and barley would take on an even more important role in what we routinely consume. Perhaps as importantly, honeybees make wild plants more productive, more luxurious, and more nutritious for the wildlife that relies on them for sustenance. Many birds, rodents, insects, and other animals would be foodless without the myriad weeds and wildflowers that grow wherever we let them. Already aware of the blessings of having honeybees in their lives, suburban, urban, and city gardeners and growers capitalized on recent events and attention and made sweeping changes in zoning and livestock laws in many, if not most, major cities. Now, along with chickens and other small stock, honeybees are back in the hood, pollinating garden crops and fruit trees, street trees, and window boxes. Bees, beekeepers, and beekeeping, they're all back where they should have always been. But where do you start? What do you need? How much will it cost? And most important, how much time will it take? If you're like me and most people today, time is important. So, how much time does it take to set up and take care of a couple of colonies of bees? The beekeeping season mirrors the garden season in a lot of ways. There's a flurry of activity in spring, maintenance in summer, and harvest in fall. Over a season, a couple of colonies will take a bit more of your time than you spend caring for your cat, but less time than you spend with your dog. Like any new activity, there's a learning curve in beekeeping, so the first season or two will require more of your attention than will be needed once you have some experience under your belt. And like a garden, there's prep work before you begin each new season, and some equipment you'll need to get started. Oh, and bees do sting. Let's get this right out front. They aren't out to get you, but they will protect themselves when they think the colony is threatened or they are in danger. But think for a moment. Bramble thorns scratch, mosquitoes bite, and yellow jackets are just plain nasty. Cats and dogs also scratch and bite. It's the way things are, plain and simple. But you wear gloves to prune your rose bushes. You wear mosquito repellent when outside at dusk. And if you don't tease your pets, they probably don't give you too much grief. It's the same with your bees. Work with them. Use the tools you have for good management and wear the right gear. Even when using gloves and long sleeves, stings happen. But if you are smart and prepared, they will be rare events. When brambles, mosquitoes, cats, dogs, the scratchy stems of zucchini plants, or honeybees.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.